Right? How many of you guys have heard of that concept before? Just a few, okay. Yeah, that's why I want to give a talk on it, okay? It's super exciting. Jonah, good, click. So we're ascending the mountains. Wow, yes. It's beautiful. Okay, some smart people to establish credibility. These are the people that I'm basing my talk off of. We'll start with John Paul II. He was a pope, he's also a saint now, he's a doctor of the church, he's a big deal, but some things that you might not know about him. He was a theologian, but he was a playwright. He loved to ski and hike, he loved the outdoors, he loved sports. And I'll be referencing his work, A Letter to Artists, which he released in 1999 on Easter Sunday. Some more smart people to establish credibility. Hans von Balthasar. I do not claim to have read his work, The Glory of the Lord, A Theological Aesthetics. It's over 600 pages. It's really deep, but I've heard like three talks on beauty that I used to kind of create this talk, and they were all referencing this work that he wrote, and he was a theologian in the 1900s. And then the last one is Plato, and we're going to be referencing his theory of forms. He lived a long time ago. I don't know much about him except for that he was a philosopher in Greece. Great. Okay, so, transcendentals, what are they? Okay, so this is largely based off of Plato's theory of forms. Plato was not a believer, but he believed in a reality that we couldn't see, grasp, or feel, which led to later philosophers who were actually Christian, or not Christians, were believers in God, to describe the realities that we couldn't perceive. And so, Plato was kind of one of the first, or he's attributed to be one of the first, that came up with this concept of transcendentals. Transcendentals are attributes of being that are found in all being, and they go through every form of being. They transcend what we cannot perceive, and we perceive them through the physical realities of this world. Okay, and the three that kind of the church talks about a lot are truth, goodness, and beauty. Everything that exists has truth, goodness, and beauty. Everything participates in some way in truth, goodness, and beauty. And everything that is truthful, good, and beautiful. Okay? At least a little bit. okay, so let's define these just so that we can kind of understand what's going on. So basically, and the way that the church views transcendentals is transcendentals are how God makes his presence known to us, makes the reality that he exists known to us. So he makes himself known through this world in all that is good and truthful and beautiful. So he's speaking to us through the transcendentals. He's saying, I exist, I love you, I'm drawing you in closer to myself. All of these things, and much, much more, through truth, goodness, and beautiful. They show us who he is. In fact, the fullness of being is God. Therefore, God is the fullness of truth, the fullness of beauty, and the fullness of goodness. Okay? Great, so let's define these real quick. But I'm mostly going to talk about beauty because it's my favorite. Truth. The mind in accord with reality is one way that we can think about truth. Goodness, ability to accomplish what it was created for. Sorry, that's a little bit of a typo. Goodness, the measure of goodness on something, the measure of something that is created to be good, is the measure of its ability to accomplish what it was created for. So this ambo, or podium, is a very good ambo, or podium, because it's doing its job. Just as we, as humans, can be more good by the more we follow Christ, the more we do what is good in the world. Our measure of goodness kind of increases, I guess, in that way. It realizes its purpose intended by its maker. And beauty. The first thing about beauty is they all three of them work in this way. Beauty exists where there is truth and goodness. End of story. So, one encounter, an encounter with truth is an encounter with goodness and beauty. An encounter with goodness is an encounter with beauty and truth. An encounter with beauty is an encounter of truth and goodness as well. They are intertwined so closely that they're kind of inseparable. Okay. And a definition for it is the perception of a form and the delight in its splendor. Okay, so let's apply something, like a flower. We'll take a flower. There were people passing out flowers on Pedal Quay today, and I gave one to Sarah. A flower is beautiful, and how we recognize that is that we perceive its beauty, and we delight in the splendor of its beauty. Okay? Cool. Jonah. So, before we move forward, I want to talk about beauty versus aestheticism real quick. Yeah, let's go into this. So, aestheticism can, well, let's start with beauty. So, beauty is theological understanding of beauty, the perception of form, delight in the splendor, an encounter with truth and goodness, and it evokes reverence and awe. It calls us to ponder our Creator. It kind of pulls us outside of ourselves so that we think of the things that are above, that we think of the things that aren't completely tangible to this reality, right? If you've ever seen the mountains, such as this presentation is all about, when we see a mountain, we're not drawn into ourselves. We actually I don't know, when I see mountains, I kind of try to look at everything all at once. It's too vast for me to even fully perceive, and I'm left to contemplate, oh my gosh, God carved this with his hand. And I think about so many things that aren't about me anymore, right? And so in that way, I'm encountering beauty. I'm encountering God through the lens of beauty, okay? And we'll talk about aestheticism now. Aestheticism, and I'm only distinguishing this for the purposes of this talk, plenty of people call things beautiful, but I'm trying to, that might not fall under a theological understanding of beauty, but I'm just going to separate the two for the purposes of this talk, okay? So aestheticism, it's our worldly understanding of beauty, pleasing to the senses, okay? And it's not necessarily a bad thing. So aestheticism, seeing certain types of people as beautiful. Beauty, seeing all people as beautiful because in them they were created in the image of God. You see, kind of seeing the distinguishing things between the two. Aestheticism, taking a picture of a mountain scene and posting it on your Instagram, not a bad thing. Beauty, witnessing a mountain scene and contemplating the mysteries of who God is. Okay, cool. Let's move on. What does beauty... Oh! No, this is another good example. Okay, so can anybody name who these people are?
Saint Teresa.
Raise your hand. Kathy, who's one of them?
Saint Mother Teresa on the left.
Cool.
Princess Diana.
Nice, okay. And okay, before we move on, I can talk about this. They're both beautiful people, and okay, so I'm not saying anything offensive, but to our worldly perception, our worldly understanding of what makes a person beautiful, Mother Teresa would not be beautiful. She would not be aesthetic. She would not be something that that pleases our senses, especially cultural, when we have these standards of beauty, right? But Mother Teresa, you can even see just in this picture right here, there is something in her that when you see her, you encounter much more than just her. There is a divine life living in her. And when we encounter, when we even just see pictures of her, especially pictures of her serving the poor, we are pulled in. We encounter both truth and goodness. We encounter God. She carries with her God. And Princess Diana does too. So they're both great. But I'm saying Princess Diana, she kind of follows under aesthetically beautiful as well. And you can see it in the way that the media followed her and not Mother Teresa in their lives. Because our worldly perception of beauty, she falls under the worldly perception of beauty versus Mother Teresa falling under almost exclusively just true beauty, encountering the divine. Cool. Okay, next slide. So, what does beauty do exactly? And we've already talked about a little bit how an encounter with beauty is also an encounter with truth and goodness. But let's put a name to some of these things. The first one is wonder and awe, inspiration. It gifts us with wonder and awe when we encounter beauty. Second is it evangelizes for us. It also evangelizes to us. Okay? And then the last one is it strengthens us to endure suffering. Okay, let's go through this one. Next slide. We're going back down the mountain. Okay, wonder and awe. This is just a little reading from the Canticle of Judas. I actually changed my presentation because I saw it this morning in morning prayer. The mountains to their bases and the seas are shaken. The rocks like wax melt before your glance. But to those who fear you, you are very merciful. I just thought that was gorgeous writing. And you can see that the writer, Judith, I'm assuming, in the Canticle is describing those things in nature that God has created that have called her to contemplate who he is. And yet, she's brought into the truth of his mercy by contemplating the mountains and contemplating the rocks and contemplating the seas which are shaken by God. And yet, somehow, by encountering that beauty, she contemplates his mercy. And I think that one is the gift of wonder and awe. We can really readily associate with beauty. So we're actually going to move on. We're going to talk about these other ones for a little bit longer. Next one. Thank you. Going down the mountain again. Evangelizing with beauty. Okay. This is JP2, Letter to Artists. In order to communicate the message entrusted to her by Christ, the church needs art. Art makes perceptible, and as far as possible attractive, the words of the Spirit, of the invisible, of God. So, JP2, he writes really deep stuff. Let's break this up a little bit. So, he's saying, first off, the church needs to be communicating the message of Christ. And one way that the church can really effectively do so is through art, through beauty. And the cool thing about beauty is that it makes the message of the gospel, which from a worldly perspective is completely unattractive. I don't want to do what is hard. You know what I mean? I don't want to give up my life for my neighbor. But through the lens of beauty, it makes that somehow attractive. That's crazy. Whoa. Okay, and I want to just share a few more thoughts. Art, this is also from JP2's Letter to Artists. Art has a unique capacity to take one or other facet of the message and translate it into colors, shapes, and sounds which nourish the intuition of those who look or listen. It does so without emptying the message itself of its transcendent value and its aura of mystery. JP2 is saying that when we take the gospel message and we describe it through beauty, through shapes and colors like maybe on a canvas, or through sounds like in music, we're not diluting the message. But instead, we're actually further communicating it on a deep, deep level. It's mystery, the mystery of the gospel, the mystery of the fact that Jesus Christ would die on the cross for us, and why? Like, why does he love us like that? And it evangelizes us too in that it transmits truth and goodness along with it. So an encounter with beauty is an encounter with truth and goodness, right? We already said that. Think of the number of worship songs that have just like simple truths that when you hear it, it kind of makes sense. The first one that I can think of is like, you're a good, good father. And the chorus of it is, you're a good father, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you, it's who I am. But there's something about the way that that song just goes where I'm able to contemplate the fact that I truly am loved by my Father in heaven, and that he is a father, and that I am his son, and I'm loved by him, and that's my identity. That's the identity that I put myself in. And through the message, through the lens of beauty, that message, which is a mystery, and it's really hard to understand, it just becomes a little bit clearer. Okay, cool. Next slide, please. Okay, exposure to beauty strengthens us to suffer. Okay, this is actually also, today I was reading the Liturgy of the Hours, and both of these, this is also from the Liturgy of the Hours today, but I thought it was beautiful, and so I switched what I had, but okay. But for God's chosen ones, there is great comfort. The torment of this life is what he's talking about. Lasts for but a short time. Then God bends down, cradles the fallen figure, whispers words of consolation with hope in his heart. Man picks himself up, and walks again toward the glory of happiness in heaven. When we see beauty, there's something in that that helps us endure suffering. And actually, Jonah, if you could click the next slide. James says the same thing in one of his letters. Count it all joy, my brethren, when you meet various trials, for you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness, and let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. Why on earth is it a joy to endure trials? Because of the beauty set before us. When we endure trials, the beauty of this is just like the faith that we have in heaven, it's all worth it, right? Eternal life in heaven makes like enduring these trials in this life actually worth it somehow. That doesn't make any sense. Beauty is just like this crazy paradox. Next slide. Okay. And exposure to beauty strengthens us to suffer. Who do we have? As just like the best and most perfect example of this, Jesus Christ on the cross. Somehow, because of the paradox of beauty, Jesus dying on the cross for us is the most beautiful image in all of human history. Nothing more will be more beautiful than Jesus dying on the cross for us. Because in that image is transmitted the truth of our salvation. The truth that God became man to die for us so that we might be partakers in his eternal life in heaven with the Father. And so a lot of theologians talk about how beauty and suffering are closely knit, and it's like really crazy and hard to understand. But the best thing to reference when you're trying to understand that is Jesus Christ on the cross. Somehow that is beautiful, that my God would suffer and die for me and for you. And let's read this scripture too. Since we are surrounded by so great a crowd of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, who, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. That we, like, were his motivation to endure suffering. He did it for us. The joy that set before him, St. Paul in his letter to Hebrews is talking about, is the idea that having known that he died for us, we might say yes to him. Because of that idea, that beautiful idea, Jesus endured the cruelest of suffering, the most horrendous suffering that we can imagine. And he did that for us. Because of that beautiful idea, he endured suffering. And because of the beautiful idea of the gospel message, we too can endure trials with hope in us that that is never diminished, that is never weakened. Instead, we can hope as we go through our trials. And it's because of beauty. Okay, next slide. And this is one last quote. A little dosage of beauty from John Paul II. Beauty makes us feel. Beauty makes us feel the beginning of fulfillment and seems to whisper to us, you will not be unhappy, and the desire of your heart will be fulfilled. And what is more, it is already being fulfilled. So I'm going to just read that again because JP too, he's deep. Beauty makes us feel the beginning of fulfillment and seems to whisper to us, you are not unhappy, and the desire of your heart will be fulfilled. And what is more, it is already being fulfilled. Yeah, so I just want to challenge you guys. We're about to split in small groups. But if you ever feel like the Christian life is like lacking or difficult for no reason, I often find that I'm just lacking like exposure to beauty. I really need to go like listen to that, like my favorite Christian song, or take a walk in God's nature and be pulled outside of myself so that I might be able to talk, or I might be able to contemplate the things that are greater than me, greater than like the sufferings and trials. So I hope you guys like can take that into account just in your prayer lives. I hope you can take that into account in your prayer lives and take that with you on your days, and like just be aware that God is trying to speak to you through beauty in this world. And he's trying to speak to us through truth and goodness. And he's doing that so that we might become aware of him and then let him pull us in to who he is. Cool. Next slide is some other questions. Enjoy.